we're in for a real treat, because we want to welcome music specialist and guest Bernie Howitt, who has been a regular feature on these programs over the years, as he's picked the brains of any number of very famous people who've made a big impact, sometimes internationally, on the world stage. And he tonight is here to pick the brains of the ASA's special guest artist, which is an Aussie girl from Campbelltown, who now lives in Nashville, and I refer to Anne McHugh. Please make welcome Bernie Howitt to talk to her.
And it's lovely to have Anne in the country. And I'd like to talk to her firstly about what's really quite an incredible journey from Campbelltown to Nashville via Vietnam. And if you listen to her music, we can go from Girl Monster and His Hell right through to a Little White Cat on Blue Sky Thinking, your latest album. And that covers such a variety of sounds and approaches in that career, places. Tell us about your journey from Campbelltown.
I was a closet guitar player. I'm very shy and, I've got seven older brothers and sisters who are very musical, so it was very difficult to join the fray. And so what I did was I ran away to Melbourne and joined a rock and roll band called Girl Monster. I answered an ad in the paper that said, wanted wild women for rock and roll band.
And if you go on YouTube, you can get some quite strong visual proof of those wild women, can't you? That were quite a live sensation.
Yes, we were number one on the independent charts. The Cure were number two. And it was very exciting. It was my first band. It was a little bit crazy. It happened very suddenly. We got together, we recorded a four-track cassette demo. 2 weeks later, it got played on Triple R. 2 weeks after that, we had a record deal. And so I was a musician all of a sudden. It was kind of freaky. And I've been a musician for 30 years.
And when, as those bands do, Girl Monster finished, where then?
It was like a divorce. It was very painful. I was out on my own. I was still shy. I'm still shy, actually. I was scared to be the front person. I had been the lead guitarist and mostly done harmonies. So I had to go and learn how to play solo, which was very scary. And I got guitar lessons with a jazz legend called Bruce Clark. So I focused on guitar. I practiced 4 hours a day and got as good at guitar as I could, you know. And because I was writing a lot of songs and I had to learn to sing them. It took a while. I went to all the blues jams in Melbourne and got more confident with that. And then I got invited to play in Vietnam. Jeff Atchison was invited and he couldn't go and he suggested I go instead. So I said yes, which is we were talking about that before. Saying yes to things is one of the keys. Things that terrify you in particular, you know. I went to Vietnam having never left the country and I played six nights a week for a year in Ho Chi Minh City. And I really got to, you know...
Yeah, that's tough breathing.
That's a
play.
Yeah. So when I got back, I finished my little EP and released it, and I got to a turning point. You know what's going to happen here? I wasn't sure. The guy from Mushroom Records loved my EP, but when I did the CD launch, which was a sold out show at the Continental. He called me the next day and said he had come to the show, but he couldn't find a parking spot, so he didn't come in. And I was very disappointed and didn't know what was going to happen. I was walking down the street in Melbourne and a guy I knew said, hey, there's a band looking for a female guitar player who can sing harmonies. And I said, okay. So I auditioned and I got the part. And we got signed to Columbia Records in New York City. So that's how I ended up in America. The album didn't come out, but I got to live in Los Angeles. And while I was waiting for the album to come out, I started going to the open mics again, you know, and I made a lot of friends and they were so encouraging and it was a really great place to be for me. It was very, they loved my songs and they said they were good, you know, and that was good. So somehow I met Lucinda Williams. I was playing in Nashville and there were 10 people at the show and Lucinda Williams was one of the people. So she came up to me afterwards and said, hey, I'm Lucinda and I really like your stuff and I'd like you to come on tour with me. So I opened about 25 shows for her and that was a really good experience.
And when we talk about your songs and your music, I love this description you gave of your music when obviously you were asked, well, what's it sound like? And I've just got to read you this description. I didn't want to get this wrong. You know, you described your music as rockin', bluesy, folk, swampy, jazzy, pop. In style, everything from Hendrix to Django Reinhardt and everything in between. Now, that covers a pretty broad palette. How do you distill all those diverse influences into your own sound, which you've done remarkably well?
Thank you. Yes, it could be my downfall. I love so many different kinds of music, so I don't really fit into a niche. But it keeps it interesting for me. I'm not one of those people who has perfect pitch or hears numbers, you know, numbered chords when they're listening to music, which a lot of people do. I just kind of have like emotions and colours and just like, so music to me, it doesn't really have genres at all. It's just got things that I really love, you know. I'm drawn to textures and yeah. So, you know, I love guitar. I love playing guitar. That's my favourite thing. So I love Jimi Hendrix, but I also love classical guitar. And so I just love everything. And I've made 7 albums, and they're all different.
Yeah, it's certainly impossible to sort of find a sound, you know, you switch from album to album because obviously that's what you feel, that's what you're feeling at that time. Yeah. And yet you've never been pigeonholed, but everybody who's seen you raves about you. Yeah. You've distilled all these influences into an incredible live show, a great tradition on record, and obviously all by being yourself and, as you've said, saying yes to people, every opportunity. So if you're sitting in a room full of songwriters who are thinking, that could be me, I could do that, what advice from those years of saying yes on the road, distilling your own original sound and being true to yourself, what kernel can you share with our audience?
Well, firstly, I think you can't stick to a plan necessarily because you're always throwing curveballs and it's like we got signed to Columbia Records and you would think, my God, that is like the ultimate. It was the biggest label at the time. But then the record didn't come out. So instead of getting depressed, I decided to go to the open mics and play, you know. So you're just always looking for new avenues. You have to be like a ninja. Every day is a different day. And you can't rely on what happened yesterday or what you think is going to happen to tomorrow. And saying yes to things that terrify you is one of the things I've always done, like playing at the ASA Awards show. Yeah.
And that's what we're about to hear. Would you like to hear how good this is? Ladies and gentlemen, a rare treat back from after quite a while. Anne McHugh is going to entertain us with a couple of songs. So please give a very warm welcome. We're very lucky and very proud to experience Anne McHugh live. It's a treat.
All right. As we were saying, I do have a lot of different genres, but I'm only playing 2 songs, so I can only play 2 different genres tonight. This is a song I started writing in Palm Springs one night at about 10 p.m. and I finished it at about 6 a.m. the next morning. can't wait to see you. I'm trying to conceal my impatience. You have a way to you, that is true. You speak of things essential. There's nothing to say, nothing to say that the truth will not reveal. You might walk away, you might walk away like a song that will not play. Will you play? And it's just shivers that make me cold. It's that feeling I've been bought and sold. It's just the waiting, it's the hardest part. It moves and shakes me in the dark. Well, I've seen some beauty in my time, but nothing came close to this. You turned a corner in my life. You took me to some places. I stood too close. Did I get too close to the things that make you special? I lay too close. Did I lay too close to the you that you will? You will not reveal. And it's just shivers that make me cold. It's that feeling I've been bought and sold. It's just the waiting, it's the hardest part. Shakes me in the dark. There's nothing to say, nothing to say that the truth will not reveal. You might walk away, you might walk away like a song that will not play. Will you play? And it's just shivers that make me cold. It's that feeling I've been bought and sold. It's just these shivers, they make me cold. It's that feeling I've been bought and sold. It's just the waiting, it's the hardest part. It moves and shakes me in the dark. Thank you so much. That's a song off my album in 2006 called Koala Motel. And this is off my latest album, which is a bit of a tribute to pre-World War II music. It's a song inspired by Confucius, who say, if you seek revenge, you should dig two graves. Please dig a grave for me, mister, and one for my so-called friend. If your back should get sore and you can't dig no more, feel free to jump right on in. 'Cause we're all gonna go, but nobody knows exactly where or when. So dig two graves for me, mister, I'm on the road to revenge. It was one cold night, San Francisco. He rolled in with a fog across the bay. What he done before, he won't do no more. His heart felt the thrust of my blade. I know you've all seen the movie. We know how the story ends. So dig two graves for me, mister, I'm on the road to revenge.
I'm on the road to revenge.